Harper One and Harper Audio present Sit, Stay, Heal, What Dogs Can Teach Us About Living Well by Dr. Renee Alsarraf. This is the author. Many names, identifying details, and some timelines have been changed to protect the privacy of individuals involved. To all those who have struggled but made it through, thanks to four legs, a wagging tail, and a warm, wet nose. I have found that when you are deeply troubled, there are things you get from the silent, devoted companionship of a dog that you can get from no other source. Doris Day. Scars are beautiful when we see them as glorious reminders that we courageously survived. Lisa Turkhurst. Introduction. For the past 29 years, I have worked as a veterinary oncologist. Basically, I treat animals with cancer, primarily dogs and cats, but sometimes an occasional ferret, rabbit, bird, or guinea pig. People always ask me, how can you do what you do? They think cancer in animals is too sad to be a full-time job. They are surprised to hear me say I experience much more happiness than sadness. I consult on cases, I provide chemotherapy, I offer radiation therapy, and I might even recommend surgery. I try to give pet parents realistic hope, another summer, or perhaps a few years of good quality time. It is an emotionally draining profession, yet it fills me right back up. Veterinary patients don't speak to us in words, and so veterinarians use empathy, along with laboratory tests, to find out what's ailing them and assist them in recovery. Even without words, animals make their feelings known, wagging their tails, giving us kisses, or perhaps growling and baring their teeth. When I can make them feel better, it makes me feel better. In fact, it makes me feel joy. Pets are amazing. Indeed, the word pet seems inadequate to describe the special role and deep bond that animals have with their human families. They provide unconditional love when the world feels harsh. We rely on them and even lean on them. I am fortunate enough to see this human-animal bond in its deepest forms. The power of that bond transcends money, age, and race, and it is without judgment. In some instances, a relationship with a pet may be the only circumstance in which a person feels completely comfortable and loved. There is no shame with an animal, no reason to put on a front. Our four-legged companions accept us as we are and understand much more than we generally give them credit for. Some people, however, do not know this bond, or maybe they don't understand it, or perhaps they haven't allowed themselves to feel it. Such non-animal people will chastise the devoted pet owner, asking, "How can you spend that kind of money to treat a dog's cancer when you could just get another dog?" Sadly, I have been asked that question numerous times, but animal people understand the truth. Our pets are not replaceable. They are not appliances. They're living, breathing, innocent beings who fill a role in our lives, in my life. In the veterinary world, happy dogs go right on being happy when they're first diagnosed. They chew on their bones, bark at the mail carrier, and continue to try to sneak up on the sofa, even if they are not supposed to be up on furniture. It is their human family who struggles to deal with the emotions of their pet's condition. I've sat with many families, counseling them through their love and their grief, focused on the mortality of their beloved animal. Their pets never understand why their human is so sad. We're told that we're different from animals. Some would even say superior to them. We have a conscience, and we can think as well as feel. Perhaps, though, we could take a cue from the four-legged among us. All cats and dogs live in the moment, carefree. They do not waste the present, worried about what might happen in the future. or how much longer they have to live. We spend a lot of time on the what-ifs, fretting about potential outcomes. I can fret with the best of them, but when has fretting ever really helped us? Can't say it's helped me. As much as I would like to emulate my animal patient's ability to live in the moment, sometimes that moment is really hard to take. I say that as the car pulls up to let me out at the cancer treatment center. It's a large gray building, bustling with doctors and nurses and support staff. I am not here to work. Today, I am the patient. That's right, I'm a veterinary oncologist with metastatic cancer. I'm the animal cancer doc with a diagnosis of my own, which is why I've come to the large gray building. Now it is my time to go through what so many before me have gone through, the C word. I hate the name of my disease. I work to treat cancer every day, and yet, when it comes to the diagnosis for myself, I can only call it the C word. Dysfunctional? Perhaps. But I detest the word cancer. It produces instant anxiety and fear in people, and I am no exception. Having this disease has felt like a sucker punch, one that I never, ever expected. I am not owning the struggle. It is not anything that I've asked for, but I will fight it with all that I've got. Now that I face this diagnosis myself, I will approach the battle relentlessly, wholly. I don't like to need help, and I'm not good at asking for it. However, I know I'll need it along the way, as will my family. When I slip off my mental train tracks, I have asked my friends to prop me back up. I'm supposed to be the mom who quizzes her son before big tests at school, the mom who guides him through his college applications. But if I'm sick from treatment, I won't be able to play that role. Will he have to take care of me? Will he pity me? Be ashamed of me? I'm prepared for any battle as long as I have hope. If I receive devastating news, at least I'll know that in the too little time I've had here on Earth, I've tried to make my part of it a better place. I've loved my child and my husband wholeheartedly, and I will always cherish my friends. I am extremely grateful to have been able to work in the field that I do. I have learned so much from my animal patients over these years. I've laughed with their owners, cried with their owners, and loved giving families more quality time with their beloved animals. But now I'm hoping for just a little more time of my own. Chapter 1. Daisy. It has been a stressful mom morning. My husband, Mike, has taken off much earlier. Lucky man. I am left with a high school boy whose last desire is to get out of bed and a dog who decided to get into the garbage that my dear son was supposed to have taken out last night. I frantically clean up while shouting for Peter to get ready to leave for school before he is marked tardy again. I drive into work with a white knuckle grip on the steering wheel. Finally, I make it to work, a bit crabby, a bit stressed, but here. My 9 a.m. appointment slot is a new case. By 9:15 a.m., I'm getting antsy. Where's the appointment? I hate to run late. It stresses me, or I should say, I allow it to stress me, because a late client potentially can put me behind schedule for the entire day. Just as I go up front to the waiting room to check, in walks a smiling blonde woman with her hands full. She's a bit disheveled, but happy and doing the best she can, pushing what I initially thought was a large metal stroller, struggling to get the device over the doorframe. On second glance, I see that it's not a stroller, but a wheelchair for her 9-year-old child, Kathy. The girl is held in place by safety belts. Tugging at the end of a leash is a panting and eager 11-year-old Cocker Spaniel, dressed in a blue princess dress, like Elsa from Frozen. Daisy, the canine Elsa lookalike, was diagnosed with cancer last week. Her family, the Johnsons, had noticed lumps under the Cocker's neck, enlarged lymph nodes. Her regular veterinarian took samples from them, which came back from the pathology laboratory as malignant or cancerous. Mrs. Johnson arrives at this appointment with the biopsy report, blood work, a copy of Daisy's medical records, and chest x-rays in hand. How she balances carrying everything while pushing her daughter and holding on to Daisy's leash is impressive. Daisy has lymphoma, the most common form of cancer that a dog can get. But Daisy doesn't appear to have a care in the world. She is wagging her stubby tail so much that her entire rear is wagging with it. She is sniffing the edges of the small exam room that we enter on a mission to find out who was there before her and with the eager hope of finding a morsel of a dog biscuit in some corner. I lift Daisy onto the table for a physical examination. I must admit, I've never done a physical on anyone dressed as Elsa, especially an Elsa who tries to lick me on my face. Silly, sweet dog. In examining the cocker, I notice that all 10 of her peripheral lymph nodes are enlarged, and that she has a bit of a heart murmur. In Daisy's records, it shows that she has had this murmur since puppyhood. But a prior ultrasound of her heart tells me there are no structural issues. Thankfully, the murmur is of no concern. I place Daisy back on the ground. She's a bit heavy and certainly fills out her dress. I go through the disease process and multiple treatment options with Mrs. Johnson. Chemotherapy is the best route for treating this type of cancer. We can't cure this disease, but chemotherapy can typically put the cancer in a remission and give Daisy a good quality of life for a year or so. Remission for this dog means that all her lymph nodes would go back to normal. Though we could get rid of all clinical evidence of cancer, eventually the cancer cells will become resistant to the drugs, and then the lymphoma will return. Treatment requires frequent visits to the vet hospital, which can be expensive. We discuss 3 different protocols, all varying based on how many treatments are needed, the prognosis with each, and the costs associated. Prednisone is a steroid pill that can help slow down the course of lymphoma for a couple of months. This is highly recommended for those pet parents who choose not to treat with chemotherapy. I try never to judge or second guess whether a family elects to treat their pet with chemotherapy. A lot goes into that decision: the flexibility of the pet parent schedule for coming in, the costs for the tests and the medications, the family's level of tolerance for side effects. In human medicine, more often than not, we are given one treatment path by the physician that we follow, often blindly. Treatment in veterinary medicine is much more of a personal choice. If Daisy is doing well, would it be okay to miss a few treatments? Mrs. Johnson asks with a knitted brow. I can see the wheels turning in her head. It's not ideal, I tell her. Everyone has things that come up, a vacation, a snowstorm. That's understandable and happens to us all. But to keep the cancer at bay, it's best to try to stay on schedule as much as possible. Well, maybe I could move some things around, she says, looking down at the floor. Sometimes we have to go to the children's hospital for a few weeks. It's not easy, I say, trying to reassure her. It's a lot. We'd work around your schedule as best we can. It would be understandable if the Johnson family opts to limit treatment to the prednisone. They have a lot on their plate, taking care of Kathy, their adopted special needs daughter. She is unable to speak, but uses some sign language. The family feeds their daughter through a gastric tube, a tube directly into her stomach, as she cannot eat by mouth. Kathy watches me intently with her dark eyes, then furtively looks away when I look at her. She glances back with a big smile that lights up her whole beautiful face. And to think, I had been stressed over morning traffic, over being late. When I was first told of my diagnosis, I felt like someone had pulled the rug out from under me. I still feel that way, and it's an empty, horrifying feeling. I replay that day over and over in my head. It was 7 p.m., July 3rd. It had been a long, busy day at the clinic, and I hadn't had time to change after arriving home, so I was still sporting a navy blue sleeveless dress that zipped up in the back with white dog hairs clinging around my hem. We were getting ready to host 17 adults and 8 kids for a big 4th of July celebration the next day, and I had stockpiled uncooked hamburgers and hot dogs in the refrigerator. I took the call, then sat down on the steps into the kitchen and hung my head. My mind raced, yet seemed blank at the same time. I tried hard to stifle the flood of emotions, but they still rushed to the surface.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.